Hey everybody. Yeah, I need to get myself a haircut. Anyway, I decided to shave because I wasn't digging the beard and it was driving me nuts. So, let's see here. Whoops. Driving me nuts. My hair is driving me nuts. Anyway, let's see. Today, we're gonna have what's in the bag. So, this is the bag. Of course, you all know that's a bag. Hello. Ding dong. All right, so now. What do we got today? All right, the first thing is, I got a Subaru Brat. Now I'm thinking this is a special edition because of the gold rims and the in the special paint job, I don't know. And see, this is what the picture looks like. So that's pretty neat. I saw that and I thought that's cool. I love Subarus. Subarus actually are some of my favorite vehicles, which a lot of you may not have noticed. Okay, let's see what else. Now, this was a perfect find. I think this is a special edition. It doesn't say it. I mean, sometimes I think that like Hot Wheels and Matchbox releases stuff that's a special edition and they don't tell you. And I don't know why they do that, but they tend to for some reason. I don't understand it. But I seriously think this is a special edition due because of the fact that the decals that they put on it. It looks, I don't know if this is a newer or older. It kind of looks a little bit like it's older, but here we go. This is a Chevy Silverado, and I think it's a special edition. Yeah, doesn't that look nice? I love that. That is probably one of the best finds I've found so far. I mean, that is really neat. And that's part of their HW Workshop series. I found this at a local grocery store. I'd like to make it back to Toys R Us, because Toys R Us normally has a lot of different things that a lot of the other stores don't sell. Especially when it comes to like Hot Wheels and Matchbox. So, I mean, we'll see what I can find. I just gotta have the time to go over there and find it. So, now, for the granddaddy of them all, one of these days I'm gonna show you the whole collection I got of this, okay? I bought the whole collection, not just in this one shopping trip. I bought the whole collection of what I have left in this bag. And this is probably the most premium thing I have ever seen that's coming out of Mattel at all. This is really neat. This is, and oh, by the way, I love Mattel. If Mattel wants to send me anything, to review, I would love it because I'll review anything, you know, toys. I'll review toys, food, electronics, anything. If anybody wants to send me any of those things to review, I will review it and I will give you my honest opinion of it. And, you know, I mean, I have been totally honest with these. These are really neat. I really love them. And, one question that I did have, I'm an avid collector, but the problem is that I don't fully understand is if you buy a Hot Wheels or a Matchbox, will and if they have a defect on it while it's still in the package, like a minor paint imperfection on it, is that worth a lot of money? Because I would like to know that. If anybody could please tell me, I would greatly appreciate it. Now, granddaddy of them all, this is a Mac. Now, it doesn't say which. Does it say a year? No, it does not say a year. But, however, this is a Mac. This is a very old Mac. Now, I don't know if they still make this stuff anymore. I don't know. I think they've gone strictly to semi-trucks. But, however, granddaddy of them all, old Mac fire engine in white. My light just went out on me. Anyway, you guys can see that anyway. So it's in white. Now, this, I am guessing, was either 1920s or 1940s. I don't know because there's no year on it. This is part of Matchbox Supreme Hero Ultra Max Wheels. What? I don't know what that other word is. It's probably Spanish or French for something. Yeah, so this, when I found the other things of this, of this specific series, I mean, that was awesome. This is probably the best Matchbox find I have found in a very, very, very long time. As you can see, it's got silver hubcaps, or silver centers in the hubcaps with red around the silver. And as you can see, they have silver around the rims. The insignia on it says, hang on a minute, I gotta step up for a minute. Sorry about that. I normally don't like to get up in the middle of the video, but you know what? That is so small I can't even read it. It's some fire department. Anyway, so this is really neat. I like collecting, especially these premium die casts, especially when they're this small. I like large and medium-sized die-cast. I like some small, but I mean it depends. One of the things that I've noticed that they're starting to bring back, but it's only like in the Star Wars product line, is I've noticed they're starting to bring back Micro Machines. How many of you remember Micro Machines? Micro Machines were awesome. I mean, yes, they were so small you were afraid you were going to lose them, but those things were really neat. I mean, excuse me. That was really interesting. I mean, it's like, how did you get that fine paint detail, you know, on that on that stuff. I mean, that must have been a tedious task, especially for the people over in Asia. I don't know if, I don't think they had machines that could do that. So, let's see. I saw some really neat photos today of Busch Gardens Williamsburg when they were being built. They just celebrated their 30th or 40th anniversary. I can't remember off the top of my head. But, I mean, they showed construction of the buildings and opening day, and that was just awesome. I have never been to Busch Gardens in Williamsburg. I have always wanted to go. I've only ever been to Busch Gardens Tampa, and I don't really remember that because I was so small, I don't even remember that. I think I was probably 5 years old. All I remember is going there. And I know they've changed a lot since the last time I've been there. I want to ride that new drop ride that they have, but I've heard that there have been, if I can talk, I have heard that they have been having a lot of problems with it. I don't know. It's to be expected, I guess, because of who made it. But we're not going to talk about that. I mean, I like some of their products. Don't get me wrong. I like some of that manufacturer's products, but the way that I can see that they can improve it is by testing their stuff before they ship it out to make sure it's going to work, or build a mock-up of it, a prototype, a working prototype, and then see if it works. That is one thing that I really loved about Aero. Aerodynamics, which is based out in Clearwater, Utah, I think, or Clearfield, Utah, one of the two. They actually built working mock-ups of their of the actual full ride. I mean, the full ride, to make sure it worked. And that's the thing that I like the most. Because one thing you guys have to understand is when you're working at an amusement park, okay, you have to make sure that all of those rides are going to work. And the light just went out on me again, but I'm sure you guys can see me. But you have to make sure that those rides work before they come to the amusement park. Because if you don't have those rides that aren't going to be working, you're not going to be making any money. Down rides means less money. Okay? I have seen instances where I have been to an amusement park and a carnival, and one of the more popular rides have been down, and you've had people that have turned around and left out of the park. I mean, it's happened. I've seen it happen. Especially, what was it? I want to say about 6 years ago, the last time I went to Kings Island, they had something that was one of their popular rides, and it was down. And I saw people turning around and leaving. And I even heard them ask for a refund. So, I mean, you have to keep all your rides running. You know, I mean, I understand that sometimes with these rides being made in especially Europe, not all rides are made in Europe, but a good majority of them are. But that's why you have to make sure that they're running every day. And that is why I think that more of the amusement ride manufacturers need to be building more working prototypes so they can get the bugs all worked out of it, and so then therefore they know what to expect once they build it into a park. I have witnessed so much because I know a lot about the amusement industry, as a lot of you may know. But like I said, not all of these videos are going to be about the amusement industry. I may separate this in the future of into a different channel, but I'm not sure yet. We'll see. The other topic I wanted to bring up was safety. All right. When you have amusement parks, you have to be focused on safety. I have seen numerous, I mean numerous cases of things, not just on rides, but in the general park itself, that are not safe, that are really big safety hazards. I have seen sharp edges protruding off fences, which I don't really agree with, because you're gonna have a parent sitting their kid on the protruding fence, and that's not gonna be a good idea. I have seen like bathroom doors that have had sharp edges on them. And to me, if you really pride yourself on safety, you need to go around and start looking at other things instead of your rides. I mean, yes, your rides are a huge priority, but other priorities include around the rest of the park too. I mean, I remember one time I was at a park and I went to get a drink from a drinking fountain, and there's brown stuff coming out of the drinking fountain. That is not something that I want to see. One of the biggest problems that I've noticed too over the years is getting college-aged people on maintenance. Okay. Now, when you do maintenance, and I know some of you may be sitting here and you're like, I know how to do maintenance. Obviously, some of you don't, because a lot of you end up missing a lot of things. But my biggest problem with getting people straight out of college to do maintenance on amusement rides is horrendous. You can have these college students, straight or former college students, straight out of college, come into your park. They go out and get drunk the night before, and then you're going to have a horrific accident. And that's not just going to fall on that maintenance worker. it's going to fall on the company that owns that park, and it's going to fall on that CEO. And if they're on the stock market, that stock market is going to go plummet right down in the ground, which is not somewhere you want to be. So you have to pay attention to what you're doing. That's why I think that you need to have better training strategies in place for especially your maintenance staff. Not just the rides maintenance staff either. I mean, I have seen, I saw somebody using a fryer once, and that fryer ended up having the wrong hose on it for the to have oil and stuff, and that hose started spewing out hot oil at the employee. So, I mean, you guys have to be very, very aware and conscious of what you're doing in these parks. Okay, and I hate to say this, but appearance isn't always what it's cracked up to be. Okay, there's a lot of things in these amusement parks that happen behind the scenes that they don't see. Nobody sees that I have seen. I mean, I have worked in the amusement industry long enough to see these things. I mean, there are literally horror stories when it comes to amusement ride accidents. I mean, they can be prevented. I mean, yes, you have somebody go up on a roller coaster and on a flat ride and look the ride over to make sure that it's operable. Now, however, luckily over the years, we have had states getting involved with amusement ride inspections, and I want to thank the states for doing that. Because without state inspections of those rides, there would be a bunch of different tragedies. So, you know, I am really happy that the states go out there and pay attention. Without the states, do I think we'd be fine? No. Especially with carnivals. Carnivals are the worst. Okay, you have so much wear and tear on those carnival rides because they are constantly being hauled on a semi-truck trailer. They're constantly being put up, put down, and put up. And you have these little pin things that you're shoving in these little holes. How is that supposed to keep the ride together? That I don't understand. And I personally don't think that's very safe. I think there has to be other choices thought of for that? I mean, you have a lot of these carnival workers who, once again, go out and get drunk, and then they go and operate these rides. Operating an amusement ride is heavy machinery. A lot of you may not think that, but it is. Okay? It's absolutely repulsive of what these carnival people do. I mean, I've been to a carnival where this guy, he really shouldn't have been operating any rides. His face was covered, literally covered in stitches. And that company is going to allow him to go out and work? That doesn't fly with me. Because you have all these kids that want to ride all these rides, and then they see him. What kind of an influence is that to a child? I'm sorry, that is just wrong. It is just darn right wrong. I don't care who you are or what company you're with. That's nasty. You must have gotten in a fight or something. Really? That's just God awful disgusting. So, I mean, I mean, okay, I can put it to you this way. You have to stay sober when you're operating an amusement ride. Plain and simple. It's kind of like drinking and driving, or driving under the influence of drugs, okay? If you're operating an amusement ride and you're drunk or high, your eyes can't physically be on the people. Your eyes can't physically be on the ride or the ride controls, which now have computer screens on them, which can tell you exactly what's wrong with that ride. Because of all the sensors that they've put on these. Okay? So, if you're not aware of your surroundings when you're operating these rides, you're not safe to operate them. And I think that more parks need to do drug tests. I think more carnivals need to do drug testings. And I literally think that carnivals need to have breathalyzers. I seriously think that. Because you have to be aware of A, the ride, B, the people, actually, people will be A and the ride will be B. And D, the safe, both C and D, the safety of the ride and the people. Now, is there a age limit to when or how old you have to be to operate an amusement ride? Yes. That is 18. Now, I literally think that it needs to be changed to the mid-20s. Because of the fact that I don't think it's right having an 18-year-old, even though they're an adult, But if while they're still in college, you know, they like to party and stuff like that. Trust me, I've been to an amusement park that's got dorms, and I know what goes on there, and it's not pretty. It's like frat parties 24 hours a day, and it's very annoying. I think that it needs to be changed to mid-20s because of the fact that by that time they would be hopefully out of college or getting ready to finish up college. I mean, there are plenty of other jobs that people in college can do in an amusement park. But like when it comes to like a roller coaster, and unless they're mentally able to do it and they don't drink or do drugs at all, and they like don't party, I think you're fine. Okay, I'm not sitting down and cutting people in college. That is not what I'm trying to do. I am trying to tell you that when you get into this industry, you have to be fully alert. The night before, you cannot be going out and getting drunk or getting high your night before work. You can't do that. Because I have witnessed so many workers coming to work hungover. Yeah, how safe is that? I mean, if any amusement park wants me to come in there and speak to the employees about this, I will. And believe you me, I will tell them horror stories of things that I have witnessed. And I mean, I'd be more than willing to do that because I have witnessed so much. Okay? I mean, yes, you have people that will come on here on YouTube and they'll show the rides. Okay? That's all great. I love that. But you have to talk about the other aspects of the amusement industry too. And that's kind of what I would like to do. Like, I have seen ticket people who sell tickets for discounted rates that the discount doesn't even exist. And that is wasting a lot of money for those parks. I mean, that is something you cannot do. And I'm sorry that this has been going out, and I'm sorry I can't help that because our lights are on this stupid timer thing. So, I mean, in another video, we will talk about other things amusement park employees do that cost amusement parks a lot of money. So. Before this monitor goes off on me again, I need to reset that thing of when it goes out, when it goes on. I just think that there's so much to talk about this whole thing. Yesterday and Saturday and Friday, I was not feeling good at all. I was sick. And still kind of am. It's like it's all up in here and it's driving me nuts. But, I mean, other than that, I guess that's all I have to talk about for today. So this is Coaster Carl signing off. Oh, and don't forget to like and share and subscribe my videos.